Hello, everyone, and welcome to Inside HealthCare. We have a great program for you. We begin with an incredible rescue during a house fire in St. Paul. The St. Paul Firefighters Foundation just recognized everyone involved in that rescue with the 2015 John Nassau Firefighter of the Year Award. A young lady is alive today, thanks to them. Here's a look at that amazing rescue.
January 31st, 2013, the fire happened. But I'll never forget that day. It was horrible. But the whole thing is you know, you have a great appreciation for what the fire association do. Actually, these guys risk their lives for our lives.
We got a call for, I think it was light smoke, but we got there and it was pretty thick.
I think the engine, they grabbed a line and attacked the fire. It was basically a kitchen fire.
The engine company made quick work of the fire. They got a knockdown on it right away. Did a great job, and we heard him say, "Fire's out."
Well, there wasn't a lot of smoke on the first floor, but as we made our way up the upstairs, there was quite a bit of smoke, and you know, we couldn't see. We had to get on our hands and knees and search each room. And well, our first search, we didn't we didn't see anything. We didn't find anything. So I went downstairs back to the truck to grab a fan, and Dan and Drew were still conducting a search.
Made it up to the second floor. And there was heavy smoke, and we do a systematic search. I went left, Drew went right, and we met back in the hallway, and there was one more room.
You know, we had no idea anybody was home. I think even the neighbor, that when we first pulled up on scene, the neighbor said there might be someone inside, but he didn't think so.
Where's Daphne? Because she gets home at 3:30. And it was horrible because she tried to call me. At that time, I didn't care anything about this home, nothing. I just wanted my daughter.
So I had a thermal imager and I was searching the rooms, but it was so thick I couldn't really see through the imager. But then I got lucky because the bed was right next to a window and some light was shining through the window and I saw her feet.
It just clicked, like there's someone here, and then Drew verbalized it because he had seen her from by the window. So I like, wow, this is it. So I radioed in right away to Chief 3 and told him that we're gonna try and get her out.
Got a call from them upstairs saying that they found a victim. So I came back upstairs.
Mike showed up right away and said, "Let's get her out of here." Our captain was right there, and Drew was at the feet, and I was in the middle. So I kind of grabbed her waist and helped her off the bed, and I got assholed in the doorway, and those two continued on, and I stayed upstairs and continued the search.
She was in some thick smoke for a long time, and I just think it's just amazing that she survived that.
It was about 10 below outside, so they had made the decision to resuscitate the victim in the front of the house where it was the least smoky, as opposed to outside in the sub-zero temperatures.
After the primary search that was done on the second floor, I was heading downstairs. Engine companies doing CPR, along with the docs were walking in too, and it's a sight to see, you know? They're saving her life at that moment.
The doctor, he came in, and it was his first time coming into a home that's actually still burning.
It was smoky. What was most amazing, though, and what I had never seen before, even though I'd been in the business for 28 years, I had never seen firefighters doing CPR in full turnout gear. This was very instructive to me, because what I saw was six, seven guys doing picture-perfect CPR with all of that stuff on, all the oxygen, you know, the air tanks, the masks. It was amazing. It was absolutely perfect CPR. I wish I had been able to film that. It was so amazing.
So one of them was ventilating her with a bag valve mask. They had a rotation of compressions going on, and they were applying an AED as we walked into the room. So we assisted with the resuscitation. I was able to put in a breathing tube. Because there was no ambulance on scene yet, I had some additional airway equipment that wasn't available in that moment. And then the ambulance arrived shortly thereafter, and we got a pulse back.
My head was so focused on Daphne, I couldn't really speak. I couldn't do anything but pray. And that's what I did. She went upstairs to wait on me, like she usually do. Got her a snack, watched some television, and she remembered the smoke bellowing out, and she tried to get on her phone, and she was afraid to come down because we only had like one way down. Because I just wanted my daughter. And I got her, got her back.
This patient and her family were very lucky that the St. Paul Fire Department is the fire department and the EMS system. The fact that it is an integrated EMS service is a tremendous advantage to the citizens of St. Paul, that not only can these guys put out fires, but they can save your life while they're doing it.
The guys on my crew, Dan and Drew, did a great job, and you know, they deserve a lot of credit for that.
But you don't think about it at the time. It's hindsight when you're kind of like, wow, you know, these events happened in a row that made it happen, and it's interesting.
Just primarily, it's you know, why we do this job is to help people, and when we can save a life, it's it's great.
It was her lucky day. It was our lucky day too, because we didn't get hurt, and you know, we were able to save her.
I'm just so grateful and thankful to everybody that played a part in saving my daughter. So thankful to the firefighters and the doctors and HCMC and Regions and just everybody who worked together to make sure she came back home to me.
Thank you.
And a big congratulations to all the firefighters and medics and the doctors for saving Daphne's life. Joining us now, we're very pleased to have with us Bill Sullivan. He's the chair of the St. Paul Fire Foundation. So thank you for being with us.
Well, thank you, Jody. It's always a pleasure visiting with you.
For some of our viewers, this is probably the first time they've heard of the St. Paul Fire Foundation. Mm-hmm. Why don't you tell us about the organization and what does it do?
Of course. Jody, the Fire Foundation is a public nonprofit organization designed to assist and complement the role of the St. Paul Fire Department. We were organized back in 2010. We have a number of initiatives. We've already accomplished a great deal of work, and I'd be happy to share that with you.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to hear about. What are some of those initiatives?
We have three essential initiatives. First, we focus heavily on the firefighters themselves. We're interested in their health and their continuing wellness. We're very interested in firefighters' education. We want to have the best trained firefighters in the city of St. Paul. And then obviously we're interested in the citizens. We want to have enhancements to the community that will assist the firefighters in doing their jobs.
And this is something above and beyond what the city provides for the firefighters?
Mm-hmm. In fact, I know there may be critics in your audience today who are wondering, gosh, the firefighters or the fire department is part of the public safety services, that's all tax supported. Why can't our taxes do this for us? And in a perfect world, that would be the case. But the reality is, Jody, this is not a perfect world. Politicians have a very difficult job assigning priorities to various initiatives within the community. This is one legitimate way for the community to give back to the St. Paul Fire Department and say, we value what you do. We think what you do is critically important. And in fact, much like the United States Marines, if the firefighters don't do their jobs, if they don't have the tools and the training to do their jobs, bad things can happen pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm. And as we saw in this story, amazing work that they're out there and they're there whenever we need them.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us about some of the things that you've been able to accomplish since you started the foundation.
Well, of course. Actually, we are pretty lucky. We have a very capable board of directors. We're led by Mary Causey, our executive director, who I really think is the brain trust for the organization. It all starts with good people.
It absolutely does.
We've done a number of things. We have a great partner in St. Paul, St. Paul Regents Hospital. We partner with St. Paul Regents Hospital, offering cardiac risk assessment for our firefighters who are 40 years of age and older. There is a tremendous increased risk, cardiac risk, for firefighters. We want to get out ahead of that. We want to be sure that we have given them tools to identify early problems, and once identified, to help remedy those problems.
I had no idea.
We work with MedCompass Mobile Health Services. We have a spirometry program.
What's it called?
Spirometry.
Yes.
It's used to test firefighters' lung function.
Okay.
It's pretty intimidating to rush into a burning building with all that smoke and debris. We want to be sure that firefighters have the best lung function possible. We do a lot in the community. We've purchased 9 AEDs. Those are the automated external defibrillators that we've placed in St. Paul schools. And in addition, we've purchased an additional 10 AEDs that have gone into St. Paul rec centers throughout the community.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's a great way to quietly make our mark in the community. We've partnered with the Minnesota Resuscitation Consortium, United Hospital Foundation, and St. Paul Fire to purchase 13 Lucas devices. These are the compression devices that are used in the St. Paul medic rigs, critically important. We've also purchased laryngoscopes for those same 13 fire medic rigs.
Again, what is that?
A laryngoscope allows the emergency provider or the physician to actually open an airway for the patient. An initiative that I'm very proud of, we are in the process of tagging or badging or providing flags for the 7,000 fire department hydrants in the city. We've already purchased our first 1,500 fire flags, and we're in the process of installing those right now. We hope in a 3 to 5 year period we can have every fire hydrant in the city of St. Paul identified. This is really important, Jody. During the winter time, when the snow mounts up,
mm-hmm.
sometimes even with the best of training and equipment, it's hard for firefighters to find those hydrants.
And seconds count in the matter of a fire.
They certainly do.
Yeah.
You know, we've got new workout equipment for the fire stations, and the firefighters seem to like that. And then finally, a project that I took great interest in, we have provided custom-made uniforms for the members of Local 21, our honor guard. We want these men and women to look sharp, and they certainly do. We're very proud of them.
Why did you get involved with the foundation?
Well, Jody, that's actually kind of a sad story, but it has a happy ending.
Okay.
Let's think. In August of 2009, one day following my 30th wedding anniversary, my mother, Tess Sullivan, who's a longtime resident of St. Paul, had a critical cardiac event in her home. St. Paul Fire Department was summoned, and in fact, mother's heart stopped on not one but three separate occasions. And what I admired then and what I still admire today was their persistence. They would not give up. And in fact, they saved mother's life.
Wow.
It was that cool, crisp, professional decision making under fire, and she's with us today. So the happy ending is mother is now 91 years old. She's living in St. Paul, and she's still as irascible as ever. So.
What a great story.
Yeah.
So if someone's interested in finding out more about the St. Paul Fire Foundation or actually getting involved or contributing, how can they go about doing that?
Probably the best way is to contact us via our webpage. Mm-hmm. That's stpaulfirefoundation.org, and you capitalize the first letter of each word.
All right. Final comments for our viewers about the St. Paul Fire Foundation.
It's an honor and a privilege to be part of an organization that I really believe in. I like the firefighters. They are funny. They are very well educated. They're brave, and I like it. I have
they're
enormous
really
respect for that bravery.
True heroes.
They are true heroes in the community. Mm-hmm. Jody, I think it's sad. We live in divisive times, and there are lots of people who take shots at public servants. This is a role of government that I think works pretty well and certainly merits our support.
Absolutely. Well, Bill, it's been a pleasure to have you with us.
Jody, as always, great seeing you. Thanks.
You too. Thank you. Still ahead, we're going to be right back with an important information about a new health and wellness initiative in the community. So stay with us, everyone.
Mom was diagnosed with Alzheimer's at 58 years old.
8 years into the disease was when all the light went out.
For me, it was heart-wrenching.
Looking into the eyes of somebody with Alzheimer's sometimes, you just don't see the person's soul is like gone.
And it takes a toll on everyone. I mean, it's a depressing disease to watch unfold before your eyes.
She actually thought those of us who were caring for her and who loved her most were her worst enemies.
More and more responsibilities fell on my shoulders.
This disease just ravages a family.
It changes your life.
The magnitude of it is indescribable. My mother taught me to be in the moment.
We have to live in the moment with them.
And I'm going to be with that person right now in this moment, wherever she is.
Now is the moment. If we work together, we can stop this epidemic.
Contact Bright Focus and learn more.
Introducing a breakthrough in time management technology. A whole new day of the week. It's called Someday. Ingenious. Perhaps someday you are going to go skydiving. Enter a hot dog eating contest. Maybe ride a mechanical bull. Now, it's on the calendar. You may want to retire someday. Ready for that? You'll really want this. A My Social Security account at socialsecurity.gov. You can estimate your future benefits, plan for your retirement, and how to save for it. If you already receive benefits, you can manage them online. Millions of people already have a My Social Security account. In fact, someone opens one about every 6 seconds. Get yours today, because someday is here at socialsecurity.gov.
Welcome back to Inside HealthCare. Now we turn our attention to what's being done in the community to help improve people's lives. And we're going to tell you about a very cool community wellness program. And we're very pleased to have back with us, welcome back, Dr.
Thank
Craig
you.
Svendsen. He's been on a guest on our show many, many times over the past 10 years.
So yes.
Glad to have you back with us.
Well, thank you for the invitation.
And a longtime community family medicine physician, so
right.
Thank you. So tell us what you're up to these days and what are you doing?
Well, these days I've spent some time working with our parish, Guardian Angels Catholic Church in Oakdale. And we've started a health and wellness ministry in response to some of the interest from our parishioners and the staff at our parish.
So tell us about this ministry. I mean, what does that mean? What are you doing?
Well,
why did you start it too?
Well, it was started as the church was thinking about having a parish nurse program or a faith community nurse network participation. And as we found from our parishioners more and more interest in this type of activity, we put together a group of interested parishioners and have started this health and wellness ministry.
So what's the purpose? I mean, what's your purpose of the organization then?
Sure. Well, we're really focusing on the general health and how to help our parishioners and the broader community as well. The community is always invited to the events that we host. And, you know, as a family physician, I always think how much I help my patients get well and all of that. But, you know, often focusing on individuals that have some illness already. And so when you think about it, it's about 80% of our health is nothing related to a family physician. It's all about our exercise, our nutrition, stress levels, body, mind, and spirit. And so with that, trying to work within our community and educate individuals about how they can improve those things as well.
And in January, you had a big event on stress reduction prevention?
Yes, we did. We hosted Dr. Amit Sood of the Mayo Clinic. He's a researcher and internist, and he has written a book called The Mayo Clinic Guide to Stress-Free Living, which has just been released here in the past year. And so we hosted him, had a great turnout for the middle of January. I prayed for a blizzard and one did not occur. And we had a great turnout to listen to him outline his research and the things that he has in his book. It was
now
very well received.
He has a whole book and you had a 2-hour program or something like that. But can you give us some of the highlights or what are some of those key messages on reducing stress?
Well,
or living a stress-free life?
I highly recommend the book because it's very practical in how to go about doing this. The interesting and fun thing that he talked about is how the human body is really crafted to respond to stress. Obviously, through the centuries and the millennia, as we're running from saber-toothed tigers and the like.
To rush hour traffic.
To rush hour traffic. our activities and our stress actually has been kind of inbred into us. And the research has borne that out. So his focus is how to be attentive to the present rather
it's
than
a hard thing to do,
stewing
isn't it?
About the future, you know, causing you anxiety or stewing about the past,
mm-hmm.
which just can put you into depression and unhappiness, and accepting where you are, focusing on where you are, and taking very specific steps throughout the week to stay focused, accept, and be grateful for the things that you have already.
Good, really good advice. So what are some other programs that you have in the works that you're planning?
Well, we hosted a nutrition event a month ago, just the basics of nutrition, how to put together a good plate of food and the proper nutrition balance that you had. That also was well received. We have pre-diabetes screening program coming up in conjunction with a local care system, and we'll be putting together a way for individuals that are in a pre-diabetic situation how they can ward off the full diabetes.
And this will be promoted in the various media, so people should be watching for that.
That's correct. And then two other things that we're going to be doing, one in May, which is Spring Into Motion. And it's how can the couch potato type person safely begin exercise? What types of things can you do simply not necessarily going off and joining a gym, although if you like that, go right ahead. But it's for the rest of us as to how we can change the activity of our daily life so that we can get more exercise. And then in late May, early June, we're hoping to put together how to be safe in the summer between sunscreens, bicycle safety, Lyme disease, and items of that sort, sharing information with those that might want to attend.
Well, they sound really good programs. So is there a cost involved if you want to attend these?
Generally, there is no cost. We try to get the word out in the local newspapers, local media, and the community is welcome, not only just our own parish members.
And if they want to get more information, do you have a spot on
I would urge them to go to the Guardian Angels webpage. Mm-hmm. It's guardian-angels.org, and we have a section on that webpage where more information can be found.
So in our final couple of minutes here, what advice do you want to leave our viewers with on how to be healthier, whether it's stress, nutrition, moving? What would be some of those key things?
Well, first off, pay attention to your health and focus on balanced eating, getting exercise, and of all those things, try to keep your weight where it belongs.
And that is different for every individual.
Different for every individual, absolutely.
Anything else?
That we just welcome everyone to attend our events, and please keep an eye out for the notices that we'll be putting out.
Well, Dr. Svendsen, always a pleasure to have you with us, and you have to keep us posted on some of the other events coming up here.
Will do, and thank you.
Sounds great. Great to see you. And great to see you. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. We hope you'll join us next time on Inside Healthcare. We'll see you then, everyone.